Yes. I'm sorry. Donna is at the school.
Oh. Okay, could I have a message with her and Julie? Okay. Okay, that's good.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to those of you who are here in church and to those of you watching online. Thank you for joining us as we celebrate the 24th Sunday in Ordinary Time. In today's gospel, Jesus shares with us the well-known and powerful parable of the prodigal son. This gospel is a powerful reminder of God's abundant and merciful love for all of us, even when we sin. And it also challenges us to be abundantly merciful toward others when they sin against us. Please remember to silence your cell phones so that we can worship God without distraction. Thank you. The celebrant and preacher for this Mass is Father Francis.
Let us begin our Mass today by singing number 682. The numbers are on the songboard again. 682, softly and tenderly.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
How wonderful to have the choir back. Oh, I'm so glad to hear you. And what a beautiful song to get us started. The mercy of God calling, oh sinner, come home. Oh sinner, come into the house. Come where the banquet is of the word and the body of Christ, and come and know the God's mercy, going even to the darkest, lowest place of our lives, the lowest places, places where we dare not to even think about them. Mercy goes there. I want to recognize that Father Donald is here. He's offering this Mass for one of our priests who died this week. He had been sick and been taken care of for a long time. His name is Father Thomas Hayes. So Father Donald is offering this Mass for a friend of his and mine, Father Thomas Hayes. We call him Tommy, Father Tommy Hayes. But anyway, so let us now enter into this banquet of love. Let us call to mind our sins. Let us admire and receive and be transformed by the mercy of God, as we say, I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts, in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Grant that we may serve you with all our heart. Through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down and at once to your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt, for they have become depraved. They have soon turned aside from the way I pointed out to them, making for themselves a molten calf and worshiping it, sacrificing to it and crying out, 'This is your God, O Israel, who brought you out of the land of Egypt.' I see how stiff-necked this people is," continued the Lord to Moses. "Let me alone then, that my wrath may blaze up against them to consume them. Then I will make of you a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord, his God, saying, "Why, O Lord, should your wrath blaze up against your own people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with such great power and with so strong a hand? Remember your servants Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, and how you swore to them by your own self, saying, I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and all this land that I promised. I will give your descendants as their perpetual heritage. So the Lord relented in the punishment he had threatened to inflict on his people. The word of the Lord. Reading from the first letter of St. Paul to Timothy. Beloved, I am grateful to him who has strengthened me, Christ Jesus our Lord, because he considered me trustworthy in appointing me to the ministry. I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and arrogant, but I have been mercifully treated because I acted out of ignorance in my unbelief. Indeed, the grace of our Lord has been abundant, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. This saying is trustworthy and deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Of these, I am the foremost. But for that reason, I was mercifully treated, so that in me as the foremost, Christ Jesus might display all his patience as an example for those who would come to believe in him for everlasting life. To the King of ages, incorruptible, invisible, the only God, honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
With you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to listen to Jesus. But the Pharisees and the scribes began to complain, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So to them he addressed this parable. What man among you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, would not leave the 99 in the desert and go after the one, the lost one, until he finds it? And when he does find it, he sets it on his shoulders with great joy. And upon his arrival home, he calls together his friends and neighbors and says to them, "Rejoice with me, because I have found my lost sheep." I tell you, in just the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who have no need of repentance. Or what woman, having 10 coins and losing one, would not light a lamp and sweep the house, searching carefully until she finds it? And when she does find it, she calls together her friends and neighbors and says to them, "Rejoice with me, because I have found the coin that I had lost." In just the same way, I tell you, there will be more rejoicing among the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Then he said to them, "A man had two sons, and the younger son said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of your estate that should come to me.' So the father divided the property between them. After a few days, the younger son collected all his belongings and set off for a distant country, where he squandered his inheritance on a life of dissipation. When he had freely spent everything, a severe famine struck that country, and he found himself in dire need. So he hired himself out to one of the local citizens, who sent him to his farm to tend swine. And he longed to eat his fill of the pods of which the swine fed, but nobody gave him any. Coming to his senses, he thought, 'How many of my father's hired workers have more than enough food to eat? But here I am dying of hunger. I shall get up and go to my father, and I shall say to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son. Treat me as you would treat one of your hired workers." So he got up and went back to his father. While he was still a long way away, his father caught sight of him and was filled with compassion. He ran to his son and embraced him and kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son." But his father ordered his servants, "Quickly, bring the finest robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Take the fatted calf and slaughter it. Then let us celebrate with a feast, because this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found." Then the celebration began. Now, the older son had been out in the field, and on his way back, he neared the house. He heard the sound of music and dancing and called one of the servants and asked him what this might mean. The servant said to him, "Your brother has returned, and your father has slaughtered the fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound." He became angry, and when he refused to enter the house, his father came out and pleaded with him. He said to his father in reply, "Look, all these years I served you, and not once did I disobey your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat to feast on with my friends. But when your son returns, who swallowed up your property with prostitutes, for him you slaughtered the fat calf." He said to him, "My son, you are here with me always. Everything I have is yours. But now we must celebrate and rejoice, because your brother was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found." The Gospel of the Lord. Well, last week, Father Roberto talked to us about a wounded heart, a wounded faith, and he preached very beautifully. And this week, we're a little sad because we're going to be saying goodbye to him after all the masses. We'll have a reception, but the food will cheer you up. There's some good food there. I have experience with it. Anyway, after Mass, we'll have a chance to come and appreciate him and tell him thank you, and everyone gets a chance to talk to him. But it's sad to say goodbye. And Father Roberto, in his homily last week, he talked about how 5 years ago, when the Western Dominican province, we closed our Dominican missions in San Diego, University of San Diego, University of Riverside, and in Antioch, California, where Father Roberto had been. And Father Roberto was heartbroken that the parish that he loved so much there was now going to be turned over to the diocesan priests, and he felt very unappreciated. And so when he came here, he admitted, and last Sunday he talked about how he was in need of healing of his heart and how appreciative he was for you, because this parish has such great love, such beautiful love, and that healed him. And he gave testimony to how different he is now than when he arrived here because of you. You have made him stronger, and you have made him whole again. His heart, though broken, has now been healed, and his faith is made stronger. There's another thing that's sad about today. Today, this last week, Queen Elizabeth died. And a lot of, for a lot of people, especially of Anglo background, English, or not so much the Irish, but And Margaret, I don't know about the Scottish either, actually, but Queen Elizabeth, you know, was really, she's our only queen our whole life. And so it's like, oh, wow, to have her die is a big change. We don't know about her son yet. Okay. And also, today is the 21st anniversary of 9/11. And whenever we come to this day, we pray for safety in our country, we pray for peace, and we pray for all those victims. And we, those of us who remember that, will never get out of our minds the pictures of burning buildings, skyscrapers, and destroyed airplanes, fields of debris in Pennsylvania and in front of the Pentagon in Washington, D.C., and even the glimpses that we hate to think about of bodies falling from the World Trade Center. So those images have wounded our hearts because this was our country that was attacked, and it came from within our country, and we are, and of course, it makes us feel less safe. So we continue with this theme of the broken hearts, wounded hearts, and wounded faith. And we have a gospel today, in fact, a Sunday filled with readings that announce great joy. And we need this joy right now to remind us that God has not abandoned us. And here's the clincher: even in our sins, God does not abandon us. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. That line came from the second reading today. I know you heard it, but maybe you were dozing in your mind, so that I underscore it again. St. Paul says to Timothy, Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And so that brings us to this gospel today, where Jesus tells, he has to defend himself against the Pharisees and the scribes who are criticizing him and complaining that he eats with sinners. He sits with the sinners and he eats with them, something that they would never do, because it would make them unclean. Well, so he tells them three parables. And the first parable resonates deeply with Jewish scriptures about God as their shepherd. And so Jesus talks about a shepherd who has a flock of 100 sheep. One of them wanders off, and he leaves the 99 in the desert by themselves. He turns his back on them, and he goes after the one lost sheep. Now, who would do that? None of us, probably. We would just say, well, lost a sheep, let's keep the 99 together. Well, but this one is not like other shepherds. God is not like us. And so we pay attention to what Jesus says about this particular shepherd who illustrates God. Because for God, the lost sheep is as important as all of the rest. And this is an important thing for us to take in and listen. When we sin and we wander astray, we are more important to God than everyone else. It's like we're the only one. Now, we're going to return to that a little bit more. Does God really abandon the 99? No, God does not abandon the 99. God is with everyone. And God, God works individually with each one of us when we sin. When we sin and we're asserting our egos and turning our back on God, God does not turn his back on us. And he comes after us. So the end of the story is the man returns with the lamb with the sheep on his shoulders, having found the sheep, and he rejoices with his friends. And the conclusion is there will be more joy in heaven over one soul that repents than over 99 faithful who do not need repentance. Actually, it just says, who do not need repentance. That's a key thing. We're getting to that. Now, the second reading, and I have to thank Father Donald for bringing this up when we had a small reflection group in the priory about the gospel. And Father Donald made a beautiful explanation that the wife with the 10 coins might have had, might be talking about the wedding band that went around her head. In that culture, and in many cultures, even still today, traditional cultures in the Middle East, brides will wear a veil and a band around their head with 10 silver coins. And that could possibly be the case with this second parable, where a woman has 10 coins. Let's think maybe she's a wife, and she loses one of those coins. Maybe it has fallen out. Maybe one of her children was playing with it and lost it. But she panics because the loss of one coin could mean that her husband, who will find out that she has lost that coin, will be seen as one who his wife has deceived, that perhaps his wife has not been honest with him, and he will suspect her, and he will be seen as married to a not a good wife. And in that culture, a husband could divorce his wife for the slightest thing and send her back to her husband, to her father and her home, and kick her out of his house. That really happened. And so the law did not protect the wife as it does today, as our law does today, but not in Jesus's time. So she is panicking, and she turns the house upside down and to find this coin. And no wonder her joy is so ecstatic when she finds it, and she calls her friends and neighbors over. Look, I have found my lost coin. And Jesus says, thus there will be more rejoicing among the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Okay, so Jesus has said that twice, and now comes the most important parable, and possibly one of the most important parables any of us have ever heard. A man had two sons, and the youngest one says, Father, give to me the part of the inheritance that is mine. And the father does so. We don't know why, but the father does so, and the boy takes all his possessions and moves away to a distant land. There in that land, because he's immature and he's egotistical and he's impulsive, he squanders all the money that he has and on a life of dissipation. And then disaster hits that country, and there's a famine. And he has to hire himself out to one of the local citizens of that faraway land, who puts him to work taking care of his pigs, taking care of his swine. And that of course, is a huge insult in a Jewish community, to hear somebody having to take care of such an unclean animal. And there that boy is. He's become a shadow of what he looked like before. He's been starving. Nobody will give him anything. They turn their back upon him, and it's just the pigs and the food they're eating, and he longs to fill himself with that food, but nobody gives him anything. And finally something clicks. This is what God is talking about. Something clicks, but in the boy it clicks only partly. Clicks in him is that, you know, how many of my father's employees have more than enough to eat? I know what I shall do. I shall give this prepared speech to my father. Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I do no longer deserve to be called your son. Anyway, so he goes back, and while he is still far away, Jesus very carefully says, look at this. God doesn't wait for us to get all the way to him. God runs out to meet us. How many times have we been those who squandered? We've squandered God's graces, His mercy to us, and we have returned back to our old sins, and we have fallen back into our old sins. But God does not abandon us, and God is waiting patiently for something to click back, to come back to my Father, to come back to our Father, our true Father, who is God. And so here the old man sees his son afar off, still away. He's still a distance, but he rushes out to meet him. He runs. Just imagine, in your old age, running, to meet your son. It doesn't look very pretty. You're not Bruce Jenner. Wait, that's not a good example anymore. But anyway, you're not some, famous athlete. It looks indignant. And so the son sees his father coming, prepares a speech, gets ready to say it, and the father says, "No, get the servants, bring the most expensive robe, bring the rings, bring sandals, bring them home, and kill the fatted calf, and let's celebrate because the son of mine was dead and now he is alive." So comes the second half, which is longer than the first half. What about the older brother? And if we can see ourselves as the younger son, now we're going to see ourselves in the older brother, because he is indignant. What is happening here? And the father comes out to beg that he come into the house. And he says, "But Father, I've always been faithful to you. You've never given me anything." The father says, "Son, all I have is yours. Everything I have is yours. You look stupid outside here. You look ridiculous. Come into the house." But here Jesus leaves us on a cliffhanger. Jesus does not tell us what the son does. And we probably know what the Pharisees and the scribes do. They end up putting Jesus to death, conspiring to put him to death. But what do we do when the sinner comes to the church and comes back into God's graces? What do we do? Here comes somebody covered with their shame, with their the same shame that we had when we first made our way back to the Lord at some point in our life of true repentance and true coming to Him and really needing His mercy. Did God punish us then? No, God is gentle to us. God is gentle. He's gentle to each one of us, and He gives us all His attention. His salvation is meant, for you and for me at that moment. And we're more important than anyone else. It's, God saves souls one at a time and brings us into the church. And here, we have the decision to make. If we come into that house, am I willing to love who Jesus loves? Am I willing to love those people covered with sin? Maybe they have STDs. Maybe they have, something, a bad history. And yet they're called and they've responded. What will I do? Will I be like the scribes and the Pharisees? Will I be like the older brother? This is the key of this whole gospel. Jesus Christ came to earth to save sinners. Will I enter the celebration, or will I stand out there, outside the house, outside with the older brother?
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation,
he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day. He ascended into in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. Look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Our loving Good Shepherd seeks us out when we are lost, and he listens to the prayers we bring to him this day with compassion and kindness.
In thanksgiving for the many times God has sought us out when we have strayed, forgiven us, and renewed us by his love, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we might overcome the temptation to judge others and instead be instrument of God's compassion to those who are different and those who feel rejected by others, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For forgiveness, reconciliation, and healing in our families, in our society, and in our world, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
On this 21st anniversary of the 9/11 attacks, we pray for peace in the world and for conversion of all violent hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are suffering from the extreme weather and natural calamities throughout the world, and that we might take better care of this beautiful planet God has given to us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the birthdays of Rochelle Joy and Rosalyn Ochoa, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions written in our book of prayer, and for all the intentions we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, we rejoice in the abundant mercy and life you offer us. Hear these prayers we make in the name of Jesus, your Son and our Good Shepherd, who is Lord forever and ever. Amen.
Yeah.
pray, dearly beloved, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Look with favor on our supplications, O Lord, and in your kindness accept these your servants' offerings, that what each has offered to the honor of your name may serve the salvation of all through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death. And by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels and all the hosts and powers of heaven, without end, we acclaim. Holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness, make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be brought together, we may be gathered into one
by the Holy Spirit. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. And with love, let us turn to one another and share the sign of the peace of Christ. Participating online, and for those who do not receive communion, we pray together now the act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present.
I believe that you are present
in the most holy sacrament.
In the most holy sacrament.
I love you above all things.
I love you above all things.
And I desire to receive you into my soul.
And I desire to receive you into my soul.
Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart.
Come at least spiritually into my heart.
I embrace you as if you were already there.
I embrace you as if you were already there.
And unite myself wholly to you.
And unite myself wholly to you.
Never permit me to be separated from you.
Never permit me to be separated from you.
Amen. Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Let us pray. May the working of this heavenly gift, O Lord, we pray, take possession of our minds and bodies so that its effects and not our own desires may always prevail in us through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for these announcements. After this Mass, and after the 11 o'clock and the 1 o'clock, there will be a reception, so everybody gets a chance to express gratitude to Father Roberto and to share in some food. And there's a nice buffet of food there, so it'll be round number two for me, but I'll see you over there. I've left you some. Anyway, the carnival pre-sale ride and food tickets. The carnival is coming in 2 weeks, and so now is the time to purchase pre-sale tickets for food and for rides, and that is available in the parish office. Next Saturday, the third Saturday of September, we celebrate at the 8 o'clock Mass, the St. Monica Mass. We do a prayer for asking God through St. Monica and through her intercession for our loved ones who are not practicing the faith. This is a heartbreaking situation for many families. Their children no longer are Catholic, and after all that Catholic school and all the teaching, and they've abandoned the faith. So it's a Mass where we have a special prayer to St. Monica, who prayed very hard for her son. And you'll have to look her up to find out who he is if you don't know. Okay, and that's at the 8 o'clock Mass next Saturday here in the church. The next Virtus class on providing a safe environment for children and vulnerable adults is next Saturday, September 17th. Please see the bulletin for more information. And finally, here's a thing about the parking lot. The parking lot is not going to be available tomorrow, and that's because it's being rented out to somebody. And then the next day, all the way till September 26th, the following Monday, you won't be able to park there because we're preparing for the parish carnival. So on Tuesday, September 13th, the main upper parking lot will not be available for parking as we have rented it out, and we are sorry for this inconvenience that will cause that it will cause you. But please see the bulletin for more information. And I'm so glad that you are finally back. Welcome back, choir. Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
The peace and blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Amen.